وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال. وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى today we're gonna go through the explanation of كتاب الفتن من صحيح البخاري. We're going to be doing the chapter of trials and tribulations from صحيح البخاري. And I don't think I'm going to need to spend time on who Al-Imam al-Bukhari is and the value and the station that his book holds. I don't think I would need to do that, inshallah ta'ala. لأن الإمام البخاري is a person who's well known, and his book is also well known to many Muslims. And that it's the most authentic book after the Quran. It is the most authentic book after the Quran. And we are living in a time of trials and tribulation. We are living in a time of trials and tribulation. And there is no way better to solve those trials and tribulation than the statements of Allah Azza wa Jalla and that which has been transmitted to us from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Those two are the greatest and the best way to rectify and solve problems that the Ummah may be going through. So the kitab that we've chosen to go through is Kitab al-Fitan within Sahih al-Bukhari. As you know, Sahih al-Bukhari has many books inside it. And the book that we've chosen within Sahih al-Bukhari is Kitab al-Fitan. So all of the ahadiths that are going to be in this are going to be all authentic, inshallah ta'ala. All of them are going to be authentic, inshallah ta'ala. The word al-fitan is a plural. The word al-fitan, it's a plural. It's a plural. And it's called a broken plural. It's jam'u taksir. And the singular is fitna. Fitan is plural. And the singular is fitan. A great scholar of the Arabic language, who has a dictionary in the Arabic language, he said, Al-Imam Al-Raghib Al-Asfahani rahimahullah, he said, Aslul Fatni, idkhalu al-dhahabi fi al-nari litadhhara jawdatuhu min rada'atihi. Al-Raghib Al-Asfahani, he said, Aslul Fatni, the word al-fitan, the original usage is idkhalu al-dhahabi fi al-nar. It is to take the gold and to put it in the fire. So you burn the, what do? You burn the gold. And the purpose for doing that is litadhhara jawdatuhu. So the gold becomes clear and it becomes cleansed. That's what the word al-fatni means. إدخال الذهب في النار لتظهر جودته من رداءتي. So when the gold is taken and it's put in the fire and it's burnt, the gold shines more, and those things that have stuck to the gold are now going to go off it. Okay? That's what it originally means. But it also has other usages as well. He said, وَيُسْتَعْمَلُ فِي إِدْخَالِ الْإِنسَانِ النَّارِ. It is also used, putting a person in the fire is also called fitna. And that's why Allah said in the ayah, ذُوقُوا فِتْنَتَكُمْ. ذُوقُوا, taste, فِتْنَتَكُمْ أي عَذَابَكُمْ. Taste your punishment and the taste of fire. So, throwing someone in the fire, I mean Allah placing a person in the fire, is called fitna.
Also, it's referred to as al-ikhtibar, when you're tested. And you are put through trials and tests. It is also referred to as fitna. As Allah said, وَفَتَنَّاكَ فُتُونَ. وَفَتَنَّاكَ فُتُونَ means, we have tested you. So the word fitna is also used for testing. Fitna is not only something that is bad. It can also be in that which is good. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً. We will test you with evil and we will test you with good fitna. So Allah referred to the good as a fitna and the evil a fitna. Because some people, when they are stricken with poverty and hunger, they are more closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And some people, when they are given wealth and children, and they have safety and prosperity, they transgress and they become distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the good is a test from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and it's a fitna. Naam.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ما جاء في قوله تعالى واتقوا فتنة لا تصيبن الذين ظلموا منكم خاصة وما كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يحذر من الفتن حدثنا علي بن عبد الله حدثنا بشر بن سري حدثنا نافع عن عمر عن ابي مليكة قال قالت أسماء عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال أنا على عوضي أنتظر ما يرد علي فيبخذ الناس من دوني فأقول أمتي فيقول لا تدري مشوى مشوى على القهقرة
مشوى
مشوى على القهقرة قال ابن أبي مليكة اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من أن نرجع على أعقابنا أو نفهم حدثنا موسى بن إسماعيل حدثنا أبو عوانة عن المغيرة عن أبي وائل قال قال عبد الله قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنا فرضكم على الحوض ليرفعن إلي رجال منكم حتى إذا أهويتني يناولهم الثلج اختلجوا دوني فأقول أي رب أصحابي يقول لا تدري ما أحدثوا بعدك حدثنا يحيى بن بكير حدثنا يعقوب بن عبد الرحمن عن ابي حازم قال سمعت سهل بن سعيد يقول سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول انا فرضكم على الحوض من ورد شرب منه ومن شرب منه لم يظمأ بعده ابدا ليرد علي اقوام اعرفهم ويعرفوني ثم يحال بيني وبينهم قال أبو حازم فسمعني النعمان بن أبي عياش وأنا أحدثهم هذا فقال هكذا سمعت سهلا فقلت نعم قال وأنا أشهد على أبي سعيد الخدري سمعته بزيد فيه قال إنهم مني فيقال إنك لا تدري ما بدلوا بعدك
The author, Al-Imam Al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, he chaptered a chapter where he called it Babu chapter. First he said, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Sahih Al-Bukhari has many riwayat. Sahih Al-Bukhari has many copies. The copies, they differ on the taqdeem and the ta'khir of the basmala. Here we have on the copy that we all have, the Basmala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and then after that, مَا جَاءَ فِي قَوْلِهِ قَوْلِ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى صح? The Basmala came first, right? And then after that, the chaptering came. Like in some of the copies, the chaptering came first, and then the Basmala came after that. The riwayah of Abi Dharr عن شيوخه الثلاثة, from his three teachers, Al-Mustamli, Ibn Hamuyat al-Saraqsi, and Al-Kushmayhani. Those three riwayat, the Bab and then the Basmala came. So the different copies, they mention differ. This is the copy that we're going to use, which is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, that Bukhari said that, and then after that he said Babu Maja'a, the chapter that which has come regarding Fi Qawli Allahi Ta'ala, the statement of Allah. Then something we're learning from here. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, his chaptering is an ayah in the Qur'an. And the ayah, what does it say? It says, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً. Be cautious. وَاتَّقُوا means what? خُذِ الْوِقَايَةً. Take a prevention. The word taqwa comes from the word al-wiqaya. It means to take a shield. Take a shield. And some people, they refer to a taqwa as al-khawf, meaning to be fear. And there's no problem with that, to refer to it as to fear. Wattaqu, be a person who takes a shield from what? A fitna. Wattaqu fitnatan. Be a person who takes a shield from fitan, trials and tribulations. Those fitan, when they come, وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاسًا. When those fitan come, they are not going to be specific to the wrongdoers. يعني يعم الجميع. The fitna, when it comes, it will encompass everybody. The righteous one, الصالح والطالح. The righteous one and the criminal one, that fitna, when it comes, it will come for everybody. Be scared of that fitna. And now Bukhari wants to bring evidences for this. And now this is something that scares us. That we know that the fitna, when it comes, it's going to come for every single person, even if you are righteous. And it's not only restricted to the wrongdoers and the criminals who are up to no good. The Imam rahimahullah, Imam al-Bukhari, after that he brought the evidence for that. He brought the evidence for that, which is, he said, حَدَّثَنَا Ali ibn Abdillahi. And Ali ibn Abdillahi here is Ali ibn Abdillahi ibn al-Madini. Ali ibn al-Madini, Shaykh al-Imam al-Bukhari. Al-Imam al-Bukhari's teacher. And this is the man that Imam al-Bukhari said, I never ever belittled myself. مَسْتَصْغَرْتُ نَفْسِي عِنْدَ أَحَدٍ. Bukhari said, I never belittled myself in the presence of anyone. I mean, I never looked at someone and I thought little, except in the presence of Ali ibn al-Madini, this man. When I stood in front of him, I felt small. And Imam al-Bukhari was saying this. So here, Ali ibn Abdillah is, يعني عبد الله ibn الإمام المعروف ابن المديني رحمه الله حدثنا بشر بشر بن السري حدثنا نافع ابن عبد الله نافع ابن عمر ابن عبد الله القرشي عن ابن أبي مليكة ابن أبي مليكة هي عبد الله بن أبي مليكة هي تابعي قال he said قالت أسماء بنت أبي بكر أسماء بنت أبي بكر said رضي الله تعالى عنه may Allah be pleased with her, Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her and her father Abu Bakr, that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Ana ala hawdi. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I am at my fountain. The Prophet saying, I am at my what? Hawd. The hawd of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a nahrul kawthar. It is the river of the kawthar that was mentioned in the Quran. The Quran described for us the Prophet's fountain, how big it's going to be, the color of it, who's going to drink from it. And the hadiths have mentioned to us, من شرب منه, anyone who drinks from this fountain, لم يضمأ بعدها أبدا. The person who drinks from that fountain will never be thirsty after that. It's an honor to drink from it. It's a what? It's an honor to drink from it. The Prophet said, أنا على حوضي. And the ahadiths that have come regarding the hawd, the fountain of the Prophet, have reached haddu tawatur, multitude narration. Meaning there are many ahadiths that speak about the Prophet's fountain. So we can't reject it. We believe in it. The Prophet said, Ana ala hawdi, I will be at my fountain. Antadhiru, I will be waiting. Man yaridu alayya, I will be waiting for those who are going to come to me. Then the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, fayukhadu. فَيُؤْخَذُ بِنَاسٍ مِّن دُونِي. A group of people will be snatched away from me. The Prophet is looking at them and they will be snatched away from him. فأقول, I then say, أمتي, my people. And the ummah that's been referred to here is يعني أمة الإجابة. They are Muslims. Because the word ummah in the Sharia is used in two meanings. أمة الدعوة and أمة الإجابة. أمة الدعوة encompasses the disbelievers. لكن أمة الإجابة here means they are from my ummah. Meaning these people are Muslims. They are Muslims who are going to be close to the Prophet's fountain, and just before they are about to reach, they're going to be told, move away from it. They will be told to leave it. And then the Prophet said, I will then say, when I see them being taken away, I say, Ummati, my people. فَيَقُولُ, it will then be said, لَا تَدْرِي Muhammad, you don't know. مَشَوْ عَلَى الْقَحْقَرَى. These people have a رَجَعُ إِلَى الْخَلْفِ. قَحْقَرَى means what? يعني رَجَعُ إِلَى الْخَلْفِ. These people, they went back on their heels. These people that you are calling them ummati, my ummah, they went back on their heels. قال ابن أبي مليكة, عبدالله ابن أبي مليكة said, اللهم أو الله, إنا نعود بك, we seek refuge in you, أو الله, أن نرجع على عقابنا, that we go back on our heels, أو نفتنا, or that we are what? We are put through fitna. Underline that part. That's what Bukhari wants from the statement here. These people, as you can see, they lost the honor of drinking from the Prophet's fountain. They lost that opportunity and that chance. They're not going to drink from it. The other riwayah that's going to come is going to explain it to us even more. Al-Imam al-Bukhari, he said, حَدَثَنَا مُوسَى ibn Ismail. Who is Musa ibn Ismail? Al-Minqari. This is who he is. He's min shuyukh al-Imam al-Bukhari. Abu Salamat al-Tabudaki is his name. And he is a person, ثقة أخرج له الجماعة. Bukhari, Muslim, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, and Nasa'i. All six of them, they narrated from him. Okay? Abu Salamat al-Tabudaki al-Minqari. حَدَّثَنَا أَبُو عَوَانَةَ. Abu Awana here is Al-Waddah ibn Abdullah al-Yashkuri. عَنْ مُغِيرَةَ هُوَ ابْنُ مِقْسَمٍ. عَنْ أَبِي وَائِلٍ شَقِيق ابن عَبْدِ ابْنُ سَلَمَةَ التَّابِعِيُّ الشَّهِيرُ. قَالَ, he said, قَالَ عَبْدِ. And remember the name Abdullah when it's mentioned in hadiths, just like that. And we know there are many Abdullahis from the companions, right? There's Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, there's Abdullah ibn Abbas, there's Abdullah ibn Umar, there's Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As. There's many Abdullahis, right, in the companions, right? But when the name Abdullah is unrestrictedly said in the books of hadiths, it goes first to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. It goes to who? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. That's a benefit, you need to write that down to remember it. So here he says, قال عبدالله. That's all it says, right? يعني عبد الله بن مسعود. عبد الله بن مسعود, he said, قال النبي, the Prophet said, أنا فرطوكم. ما معنى أنا فرطوكم؟ أي أنا أمامكم. I am in front of you. I'm before you. The Prophet is saying to the Sahabas, he's telling them, أنا فرطوكم. I am before you على الحوض at my fountain. I am there before you guys. The word al-farad, ama al-farid, it means al-mutaqaddimu, al-ladhi yasbiqu al-qawma. It is the one who goes before the people. That's what it means. That's why the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith al-janaza, Allahumma ja'alhu lana salafan wa faratan wa dhukhra. Faratan means the one who goes before you. And then the Prophet here is saying, I am going to be there before you all come. I'm going to be at the fountain before you guys. The Prophet, that's what he's saying. And then the Prophet said, لَيُرْفَعَنَّ إِلَيَّ رِجَالٌ مِّنْكُمْ. A people from my ummah will be risen to me. They will be shown to me. حَتَّى إِذَا أَهْوَيْتُ لِأُنَاوِلَهُمْ. And then the Prophet said, when I try to grab them, when I try to grab them and tell them, come, drink from my fountain, اِخْتُلِجُوا دُونِي. مَا مَعَنَا اِخْتُلِجُوا دُونِي أَيْ جُذِبُوا. They will be dragged and snatched. قَبْلَ الْوُصُولِ إِلَيَّ. Before they can reach me. Before they can even reach me. Al-Humaydiyu in his kitab, Al-Jam'u, the hadith, Jam'u bayn al-Sahihayn, where he combines between Bukhari and Muslim. He mentions that, I tried to grab them, the Prophet is saying, but they will be dragged from me. Snatched before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَأَقُولُ, I then say, رَبِّ أَصْحَابِ, my Sahaba. So this shows us The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew these people in two ways. Write this down. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam knew these people. Imma bi'ayanihim, he knew their names. So it's a people that lived at the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he knows them by their name. The second one is, he doesn't know them by their name, but he knows them by description. He knows them by what? He knows them by description. He knows their description, their sifa. And the sifa that he knows them by is what? Another hadith explains that he knows them by their description. And is that he knows them by the wudu that they used to do. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned in the same famous hadith that he said, Ya Rasulullah, how are you going to recognize your companion, your people? And then he said, will it be the same if a person was to own horses that have different shades on their hooves, on their faces, they have different colors. Would they mix up with other horses that don't have that? No. And then the people who do wudu, they will be shining from their places of wudu. I will recognize them by that. So the Prophet ﷺ would either know them bi a'yanihim, by their names, or bi awsafihim, or by their description. And then he would say, Ay Rabbi, my Lord, ashabi, my followers, my companions. يَقُولُ It would then be said to him, لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُوا بَعْدَكَ You do not know what they done after you. They newly introduced into the religion. They came with innovation. These people have done bid'ah. After you died, they added things onto the religion. إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُوا بَعْدَكَ You don't know what they've added onto the religion. And they changed the religion. They distorted it. It wasn't as you were. They left your way. Now pay attention to this. These people, as we said, they're not non-Muslims. They're Muslims. But they are Muslims who've fallen into innovation, bid'ah. They came with fitnatu shubuhat. They came with the fitna of doubts. They changed the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَلِذَلِكَ حُذَيْفَةُ بْنُ الْيَمَانِ One day saw a group of people praying. And then he said, Wallahi, if Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam was with you guys now, he would not recognize anything from your religion except your salah. You've changed everything. That's a sahabi talking to the tabi'een. Imagine if he was to see the way that the religion has now been changed and things have been added onto it. Now brothers, here the Prophet said, Ay Rabbi ashabi, my companions. So does that mean that these are referring to the Prophet's companions? The scholars, they commented on this and they said, the people that are here being referred to is a group of people who were new into Islam but that saw the Prophet, but then the Prophet died before they could be with him. And it's not referring to the senior companions, it is referring to the Bedouin ones, some of whom apostated. Some of whom apostated Yawmur Ridda, the fitna that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was dealing with. But the noble senior companions who spent their time with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not referring to them. Then Imam al-Bukhari said, حدثنا يحيى بن بكير المخزومي. يحيى بن بكير المخزومي. His kunya is Abu Zakaria. يحيى بن بكير التميمي الحنظلي مولاهم ثقة ثبت أخرج له صاحباء الصحيح والترمذي والنسائي. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated from him, and al-Tirmidhi and al-Nasa'i رحمه الله. He said, قال حدثنا يعقوب بن عبد الرحمن القاري عن أبي حازم سلمة بن دينار عن سهل بن سعد الساعدي, the noble companion. He said, سمعت, I heard the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم say, أنا فرطكم على الحوض. I am going to be at the fountain before you. من ورده شرب منه. Anyone who comes to the fountain will drink from it. ومن شرب منه. And the person who drinks from this fountain, لم يظمأ بعده أبدا. He will never be thirsty after that day. Anyone who drinks from this fountain will never be thirsty after that. Then the Prophet said, لا يرد علي أقوام أعرفهم ويعرفوني. There are going to be brought to me a people. I know them and they know me. So this shows you that they were some people who were at the time of the Prophet. And also it doesn't negate that it's going to be people who are after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. ثم يحال بيني وبينهم. And then it will be blocked between me and them. Meaning, I will be blocked from them. Abu Hazim, he said, فَسَمِعَنِي النُّعْمَانِ بْنُ أَبِي عَيَّاشٍ وَأَنَا أُحَدِّثُهُمْ هَذَا فَقَالَ هَكَذَا سَمِعْتُ سَهْلًا فقلت نعم قال وأنا أشهد على أبي سعيد الخدري لسمعته يزيد فيه قال إنهم مني that these people the prophet said they are from me فيقال إنك لا تهدري ما بدلوا بعدك Muhammad you do not know what they've done to your religion they changed it this benefits are something else that the prophet doesn't know the unseen the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam All of those narrations, it is being said to him, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدِرِي You don't know Muhammad. And then the Prophet ﷺ only knows what Allah wants him to know, subhanahu wa ta'ala. عَلِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا The knowing of the unseen is based on what Allah wants the Prophet ﷺ to know. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, he said in the ayah, قُلْ لَوْ كُنْتُ أَعْلَمُ الْغَيْبَ لَاسْتَكْثَرْتُ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ وَمَا مَسَّنِيَ السُّوءِ If I was to know the unseen, harm would not have touched me and I would have increased in good. So the Prophet ﷺ only knows what Allah wants him to know. He doesn't know mutlaqul ghaib. He doesn't unrestrictedly know the unseen. Only Allah tabarak wa ta'ala knows. The Prophet only knows what Allah wants him to know. So these hadiths, they show us and they indicate to us that the people are going to lose, some people are going to have the fitna of not drinking from the Prophet's fountain alayhi salatu wasalam. And the reason for that is what? Al-ihdathu fi al-deen. Adding into this religion that which is not from it. So we now need to be cautious. Every action that we do and everything that we say in order to get closer to Allah from it, ask yourself, have you been preceded in it? Have you been preceded in it? Did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do it? Did Allah azza wa jalla do it? Don't come with anything new. Don't come with what? Anything new. ولذلك الله said in the Quran, فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا That ayah tells us that if you want to do an action, two conditions have to be met. The first condition is what? فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا Make sure that it's an action that is done in accordance to the sunnah. وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا And don't associate partners with Allah in that action. Only do it for Him. Those are the two pillars. For every action, sincerity, number one. And the second condition for every action is, you do it in accordance to how the Prophet ﷺ did it. That's why the great Imam, he said, أَطُرُقُ كُلُّهَا مَسْدُودًا إِلَّا طَرِيقًا مَنِ اقْتَفَى أَثَرَ مُحَمَّدٍ All of the roads are closed. There's no road to Allah except the path that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took. All of the roads are closed. There's no way to get to Allah except the road that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam took. So we have to tread on that path. Also, the benefit that we take from this hadith is the way that we should stop each other from evil if we see one of us indulging in evil, based on the chaptering of the hadith of the kitab. The chaptering is what? باب قول الله تعالى واتقوا فتنة لا تصيبن الذين ظلموا منكم خاصة That if we see someone doing evil, that we should stop that person from doing the evil. Based on the hadith, من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره بيده فإن لم يستطع فبلسانه فإن لم يستطع فبقلبه وذلك أضعف الإيمان If you see evil, stop it with your hand. If you know that you stopping it with your hand is going to become a greater evil and it's going to lead to a greater evil, then you can't. Then say it with your tongue. And if it's then going to lead to a greater evil by you speaking about it, then at least hate it in your heart, and that is the lowest of al-Iman. So the person, what does he have to do? We stop each other from evil. And if we do not stop each other from evil, and we watch each other do evil, then we will be cursed. عَلَى لِسَانِ دَاوُدَ وَعِيسَى بْنِ مَرْيَمْ On the tongue of Nabi Allah Dawood and Isa ibn Maryam. That's why Allah said in the ayah, لعن الذين كفروا من بني إسرائيل على لسان داود وعيسى بن مريم ذلك بما عصوا وكانوا يعتدون كانوا لا يتناهون عن منكر فعلوه لبئس ما كانوا يفعلون They cursed on whose tongue? داود and عيسى بن مريم Why? كانوا لا يتناهون عن منكر فعلوه If they saw each other do wrong, they wouldn't stop each other from it. But remember, to stop the evil is in accordance to your ability. You're not allowed to stop an evil that will bring about a greater evil. لا يجوز إنكار منكر It is not permissible for you to stop an evil. يترتب عليه ما هو أنكر منه. And from that is going to lead to something greater than it. You're not allowed to do it. As the scholars sometimes refer to it as what? Bana qasr wa hadama misra. He built one palace and he destroyed the whole Egypt. Huh? Just so you can do one good, you can't destroy everything. So it has to be in accordance to your ability. Like in the thing that you have to always come with is hatred in your heart. If you can't stop it with your hand, then do it with your tongue. And if you can't, then say it with your, say or believe it in your heart, or hate it in your heart. Also, this hadith shows us, brothers, the concept of su'ul khatima, evil ending. We should always hope from Allah that we die in a good way, so that when we our last moments, that we meet Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala upon the sunnah, holding on to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet told us in the hadith, إن حدكم لا يعمل بعمل أهل الجنة حتى ما يكون بينه وبينها إلا ذراع فيسبق عليه الكتاب فيعمل بعمل أهل النار فيدخلها وإن حدكم لا يعمل بعمل أهل النار حتى ما يكون بينه وبينها إلا ذراع فيسبق عليه الكتاب فيعمل بعمل أهل الجنة فيدخلها. That one of you does the action of the people of Jannah. All of his life is doing a good deeds, and then just before he's about to die, he flips on his heels and he becomes what? He changes and he does the action of the people of evil. And the opposite is true. So we ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala for husnul khatima. And where did I take that from? Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, these people, they changed after the Prophet went. إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا أَحْدَثُ بَعْدَكَ. They turned on their heels after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they were upon good when the Prophet was with them. And after he left them, they changed these individuals. Naam.
باب قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سترون بعدي امورا تنكرونها وقال عبد الله بن عبد الله بن زيد قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اصبروا حتى تلقوني على الحوض. حدثنا مسدد حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد حدثنا الاعمش حدثنا زيد بن وهب سمعت عبد الله قال قال لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم انكم سترون بعدي اثره وامورا
انكم سترون بعدي
اثره وامورا تنكرونها
انكم is خطا in not copy then انكم ستروني اثره
إنكم سترون بعدي أثرة وأمورا تنكرونها قالوا فما تأمرنا يا رسول الله قال أدوا إليهم حقهم وسلوا الله حقكم.
نعم.
حدثنا مسدد عن عبد الله عن عبد الوارث عن الجعد عن ابي رجاء عن ابن عباس عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من كره من اميره شيئا فليصبر فانه من خرج من السلطان شبرا مات ميتة جاهليه. حدثنا أبو النعمان حدثنا حماد بن زيد عن الجعد بن عثمان حدثني أبو رجاء العطاردي قال سمعت ابن عباس رضي الله عنه عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من رأى من أميره شيئا يكرهه فليصبر عليه فإنه من فارق الجماعة شبرا فمات إلا مات ميتة جاهلية. حدثنا إسماعيل حدثني ابن وهب عن بكير عن بسر بن سعيد عن جنادة بن أبي أمية قال دخلنا على عبادة بن صامت وهو مريض قلنا أصلحك الله حدث بحديث ينفعك الله به سمعته من النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال تعالى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فبايعناه فقال فيما أقبل علينا أن بايعنا على السمع والطاعة في من شرنا ومكرهنا وعسرنا ويسرنا وأثرة علينا
أن لا ننازع الأمر
وأن لا ننازع الأمر أهله إلا أن تروا فيه كفرا بواحا عندكم من الله فيه برهان. حدثنا محمد بن عرعرة حدثنا شعبة عن قتادة عن أنس بن مالك عن أسيد بن حضير أن رجلا أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال: يا رسول الله استعملت فلانا ولم تستعملني؟ قال: إنكم سترون بعدي أثرة فاصبروا حتى تلقوني.
الإمام البخاري here he chaptered باب قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the chapter of the statement of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, سترون, you will see, بعدي, after me, أموراً, issues. After my death, the Prophet is saying, you're going to see, أموراً, you're going to see affairs, matters, تنكرونها, that you will reject, and you will disapprove, that you're going to see that. That's a portion of a hadith. وقال عبد الله بن زيد, عبد الله بن زيد said, قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. Bukhari did something right now. What did he do? He didn't mention the chain for Abdullah ibn Zayd, right? Did he do that? Did he mention a chain for him? This is not from the conditions of Bukhari, so he doesn't want to mention a chain for it. This is considered from the mu'allaqat of Imam al-Bukhari. Okay? If you don't understand it, just write it down. The hadith which Bukhari does not bring with a chain are considered from his mu'allaqat. They don't take the ruling of the hadith which are with his chains. وقال عبد الله بن زيد, عبد الله بن زيد said, عبد الله بن زيد ابن عاصم, that's who he is. He said, قال النبي, the Prophet said, اصبروا, be patient, حتى تلقوني على الحوض, be patient until you meet me at my fountain. Underline the word be patient. Underline that part of the hadith. Be patient. Because I'm going to revise that so many times, inshallah ta'ala. And Imam al-Bukhari, he said, حدثنا مسدد. مسدد, who is he? Is مسدد ابن مسرحد السدوسي الإمام المعروف. And the funny thing about this great Imam's name is, some people, they said, because his name is مسدد ابن مسرحد, مسدد ابن مسرحد, some people, they said that his name actually rhymes for a long way. They said his name is مسدد ابن مسرحد ابن مسربل ابن مغربل ابن مرعبل ابن أرندل ابن سرندل ابن غرندل. All of that, ما أنزل الله بها من سدد. There's no evidence for that. That's not his name. His name is مسدد ابن مسرحد ابن مسربل ابن مستورد. That is his name. He's a great imam. And you see him a lot in Sahih al-Bukhari. Bukhari narrated from him and Abu Dawud narrates from him. And Imam Abu Dawud narrate from him a lot. They narrate from him the most. They narrate from him. Khasatan Abu Dawud narrates from him a lot. He said, مسدد ابن مسرحد, he said, قال حدثنا يحيى بن سعيد. Who's يحيى بن سعيد? يحيى بن سعيد القطان, الإمام المعروف. يحيى بن سعيد القطان, the great Imam, يحيى بن سعيد ابن فروق القطان التميمي, ثقة ثبت إمام أخرج له جماعة. يحيى بن سعيد القطان. قال, he said, حدثنا الأعمش سليمان بن مهران. سليمان ابن مهران الأعمش. قال, he said, حدثنا زيد بن وهب الجهني. قال, he said, سمعت عبد الله. Who is this عبد الله? How do you know? Does it say عبد الله بن مسعود? It just says عبد الله, right? And then عند الإطلاق is عبد الله بن مسعود. قال, سمعت, I heard, عبد الله يعني بن مسعود. قال, قال لنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the Prophet said to me, the Prophet said to us, sorry, إنكم يو سترون بعدي أثرة. لكن some of the copies, it mentioned أُثْرَةً. صحيح. Are we all together? لكن some of the scholars, they consider that to be a mistake. لكن إن شاء الله تعالى, we will say كلاهما صحيح. أثارةً. What does the word أثارةً means? After me, you are going to see. حافظ بن حجر, he said, it means الاختصاص بحظ الدنيوي. There are going to come leaders that are going to take all the money for themselves. All the dunya is theirs. And you guys will be stricken with poverty. You will be struggling financially and struggling in your worldly affairs. and all they do is they are going to take care of themselves. That's what it is. وحاصلها الاختصاص بحظ الدنيوي. They're going to give themselves all the worldly. That's going to be for them. The Prophet is saying to us, إنكم سترون, you will see بعد after me أثرة. أثرة means what? Leaders who are going to choose for themselves. They are going to choose for themselves everything that's good in the worldly affairs. That's what they're going to do. The Prophet is telling us, عليه الصلاة والسلام. وَأُمُورًا, and you're going to see that from them, أُمُورًا تُنْكِرُونَهَا. The first part it says, أَثَرَةً means what? They're going, the worldly, they're going to take it for themselves. وَأُمُورًا تُنْكِرُونَهَا means what? You're going to see from them, مُخَالَفَةً شَرْعِيَةً. They're going to go against the religion. They're going to do what? They're going to do things that go against the Sharia. For example, they are going to come with, مثلاً, شُرْبُ الْخَمْرِ, drinking alcohol. Or they're going to zina. وَمَا إِلَى ذَلِكَ. You'll see from them, وَأُمُورًا تُنْكِرُونَهَا, things that you're going to reject. The Prophet is now saying to us, what should we do here when this happens? The Sahabas, they said, look what they did. These leaders who are going to come are going to take from the people their wealth, and they're going to keep it for themselves. And also what they're going to do is, they're going to go against the Sharia, the religion that Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came with. They're going to change it and alter it. The Sahabas, they said, فَمَا تَأْمُرُنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. What do you command us to do to these leaders? How should we deal with them? The Prophet said, أَدُّوا إِلَيْهِمْ حَقَّهُمْ. Fulfill their rights. The rights that you need to do for them, give it to them. What is the wajibat that is upon us to do for them? And what are the things that we need to do for them is obedience and listening to them. And the zakat money, giving it to them. If they request zakat money to be given to them, it's given to them. And if they announce jihad and they call you to come, you go with them. And if they pray in a place that they come and they, because back in those times, the leaders used to lead the people in the Jum'ah and the Jama'at. And the khutab and the Eid were done by the leaders. You come and you pray with him. Even if he's an alcoholic, even if he's a zani, even if he's coming mukhalafat shar'iyyah, you have to come. Are we all together? That's what the Prophet is saying to them, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Sahabas asked that question on our behalf. فَمَا تَأْمُرُنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. O Messenger of Allah, what do you command us to do? A people who have taken the dunya from us. A people who they've left, abandoned the religion in implementing it on themselves. They've done that, they've abandoned it. فَمَا تَأْمُرُنَا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. O Messenger of Allah, what do you command us to do? The Prophet said, أَدُّوا إِلَيْهِمْ حَقَّهُمْ. Give them the rights that they have on you. There are rights they have on you, right? Which is what? To listen and to obey them. That's rights that they have on you. You listen and you obey them. That's what you do. We'll come to it, inshallah ta'ala, in more details what we mean by that. And what else do you do? وَسَلُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّكُمْ. What about our rights that they're not giving to us? What do we do with that? Should we go and fight them to get our rights? The Prophet said, ask Allah for your rights, inshallah ta'ala. وَسَلُوا اللَّهَ. Ask Allah for your rights. Make dua, say, oh Allah, bring me back my haqq that was taken from me unjustly. Nabiullah Muhammad is saying that. حَدَّثَنَا مُسَدَّدْ ibn مُسَرْحَدٍ السَّدُوسِيُّ. He said, okay, عَنْ عَبْدِ الْوَارِثِ. He said, عَبْدِ الْوَارِثِ here is Ibn Sa'idin. عَنِ الْجَعْدِ, he's Abu Uthman al-Sayrafi. عَنْ أَبِي رَجَاء, his name is عمران العطاردي. عَنْ ابْنُ عَبَّاسٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهُمَا. May Allah be pleased with Abdullah ibn Abbas and his father, who are both companions. عَنِ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the Prophet said, pay attention to this, مَنْ كَرِهَ مِنْ أَمِيرِهِ شَيْئًا. Anyone who dislikes something from his leader, فَلْيَصْبِرْ. Underline it again, be patient. Anyone who sees from his leader that which does not please him, which doesn't like. Again, what is it that we will see from the leader that won't be pleasing to us? The hadith before told us. What is it? أَثَارَةً. They will take the worldly affairs from us. And they're going to come with مُخَالَفَةً شَرْعِيَةً. Religious issues that are going against the religion in great issues. The Prophet told us when they come with those two, فَلْيَصْبِرْ. Be patient. Be patient. Then the Prophet told us, if the person is not patient, what is he going to do? He's going to do the opposite, right? Which is to what? Go against them. The Prophet said, فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ خَرَجَ مِنَ السُّلْطَانِ. Anyone who says, I'm going to go against the leader. Shibran. Shibran is this much. That's all it is. صح? Mata, and then the person dies. He goes outside, on the outskirts of the city. And he says, I'm not going to be under this. He leaves it. If he dies, mata meetatan jahiliyah. He dies the death of jahili. What does that mean? We'll come to it inshallah soon. That person is dying the death of the jahili. What does that mean? We'll come to that inshallah and the kalam of Ibn Hajar on it. Al-Imam al-Bukhari said, حدثنا Abu Nu'man. Who's Abu Nu'man that Al-Imam al-Bukhari is narrating from here? Is Muhammad ibn al-Fadl, who's known as Bi'arimin. Qala, he said, حدثنا حماد بن زيد وهو ابن درهم عن الجعدي وهو ابن دينار الصيرفي عن أبي عثمان حدثني أبو رجاء عمران العطاردي قال سمعت ابن عباس رضي الله تعالى عنهما عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من رأى من أميره شيئا يكرهه. Anyone who sees from his leader that which he dislikes, فليصبر عليه, be patient on it. فإنه من فارق الجماعة. Anyone who leaves the unity of the Muslims. How are the Muslims united? The Muslims are all united under this leader. You're going to cut off from the leader. You're going to cut away from the jama'ah. And you're going to put a flag for yourself. Give yourself a name. Anyone who does that. فَإِنَّهُ مَنْ فَارَقَ الْجَمَاعَةِ شِبْرًا أي شِبْر فَمَاتَ and he dies. إِلَّا مَاتَ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَةً except that you die the death of jahiliyah. قال الإمام البخاري حدثنا إسماعيل. الإمام البخاري, he said, إسماعيل, who is Ibn Abi Awais. حدثني ابن وهب عن عمرو ابن الحارث عن بكير and he is عبد الله ابن الأشجي عن بسر ابن سعيد عن جنادة ابن أبي أمية السدوسي قال دخلنا على عبادة ابن صامت. We entered onto عبادة ابن صامت, a companion. عبادة ابن صامت is أحد النقباء في العقبة. He was from the people that the Prophet ﷺ gave pledge of allegiance to. The three times that the Prophet ﷺ Al-Bay'ati al-Thalatha, before the Prophet came to Medina, Ubadah was from the people who came the three times. He was present in all three of them. Ubadah ibn Samit, he's an elite companion from the people of Ansar. They said, دخلنا, we entered onto على Ubadah ibn Samit, his companion. وَهُوَ مَرِيضٌ and he was sick. Then we said to him, أَصْلَحَكَ اللَّهُ, may Allah give you recovery from your illness. أَصْلَحَكَ اللَّهُ here means may Allah rectify your health. It doesn't mean may Allah strengthen your iman. Or it doesn't mean the religion of Ubadah ibn Samit. It means his health, he was sick. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala give you quick recovery from your illness. Then they asked him for something. حَدِّثْ, tell us. بِحَدِيثٍ أي حَدِيثٍ يَنْفَعُكَ اللَّهُ بِهِ أي حَدِيث that Allah will benefit us through you. Give us one hadith that you heard from the Prophet that will benefit us. سَمِعْتَهُ مِنَّ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ that you heard the Prophet from. قَالَ he said, دَعَانَ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ فَيَبَايَعَنَاهُ. Ubad is a companion. There were thousands of hadiths he could have chosen. He chose to tell this hadith. He said, we did a pledge of allegiance with the Prophet. We gave the Prophet bay'ah. And the bay'ah that we gave the Prophet was this. أَنْبَايَعْنَا عَلَى السَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَةِ. We gave pledge of allegiance to listen and obey. What are we going to obey? في منشطنا ومكرهنا. منشطنا means what? At our times of ease. منشطنا means when we are nashat, enthusiastic, we listen and we obey the leader. ومكرهنا means what? أي عجزنا, when we're lazy and we can't be bothered, we still listen and we obey. See, you're not always in the mood to listen and obey, right? We took a pledge of allegiance that we will listen at the times that we're enthusiastic and the times when we're lazy. Well, also it means we will obey فيما نريده وفيما لا نريده. We'll obey him in the things that we want and we will also obey him in the things that we don't want. That's what it means. وَعُسْرِنَا وَيُسْرِنَا the times of hardship and the times of ease. وَأَثَرَةٍ عَلَيْنَا and the time when he's even taken our wealth unjustly and he's being unfair to us and he's oppressing us, we will still listen and obey him. See what he's doing? He's taking the people's wealth, he's lashing them, he's unjust to them. We'll still listen to him and we will obey him. وَأَلَّا نُنَازِعَ And from the Pledge of Allegiance was, أَلَّا نُنَازِعَ That we are not going to pull back, or we're not going to compete with these leaders by trying to huggle them out of their positions. The people of authority, we're not going to try to push them out of their positions. إِلَّا أَن تَرَوْا Unless you see كُفْرًا Clear cut كُفْر You see كُفْر بَوَاحًا عِنْدَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ فِيهِ بُرْحَانٍ You see kufr, which is clear-cut, that you can use evidence the Day of Judgment. So if this issue is disputed whether it's kufr or not, it's outside the discussion. If he's doing it behind closed doors and it's not out in the open, a YouTube clip that you watched, or he or fulan said, that's not kufr بَوَاحْ عِنْدَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ فِيهِ بُرْحَانٍ Are we all together? Hadith say to you what? Illa an taraw until you see. Not what you saw on YouTube. Or not what you saw online. Not what you were informed of. Illa an taraw unless you see. Kufran, disbelief. Bawahan, that is crystal clear. Indakum min Allahi fi burhan. And you have evidence for it the day of judgment. That's when you're allowed to go against him. And even then we'll speak about what the scholars said about it. Let me read some of the statements of the great scholars, what they said about this issue. This hadith, the ones hadith before it, if you underline the point where it says, أَدُّوا إِلَيْهِمْ What does it mean, أَدُّوا إِلَيْهِمْ? أَدُّوا إِلَيْهِمْ means, Ibn Hajar says, أَيْ إِلَى الْأُمَرَاءِ Fulfill the rights to these leaders. What is the rights that we have to fulfill for them? أي الذي وجب لهم المطالبة به وقبضه سواء كان يختص بهم أو يعم. Whether it's something that's specific for them, they ask for you to do for them, or whether it's something general, you listen, you do it for them. He wants a personal favor from you. He goes, I'm not going to do this personal favor for you. Whatever it is, you do it and you listen, you obey. That's what he's saying. This hadith, some scholars they said, look at it. وَسَلُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّكُمْ Ask Allah your rights. It was referring to the people of Ansar and it's specific to them. How can we take this hadith general? Ibn Hajar responds to that and he says, وَلَا يَلْزَمُ مِنْ مُخَاطَبَةِ الْأَنصَارِ بِذَلِكَ أَنْ يَخْتَصَّ بِهِمْ فَإِنَّهُ يَخْتَصُّ بِهِمْ بِالنِّسْبَةِ إِلَى الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَيَخْتَصُ بِبَعْضِ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ دُونَ بَعْضٍ فَالْمُسْتَأْثِرُ مِنْ يَلِي الْأَمْرَ وَمَنْ عَدَاهُ هُوَ الَّذِي يَسْتَأْثِرُ عَلَيْهِ ولما كان الأمر يختص بقريش ولا حظ للأنصار فيه خوطب الأنصار بأنكم ستلقون أثرة وخوطب الجميع بالنسبة لمن يلي الأمر فقد ورد ما يدل على التعميم ففي حديث يزيد بن سلمة الجعفي عند الطبراني أنه قال يا رسول الله إن كان علينا أمراء يأخذون بالحق الذي علينا ويمنعون الحق الذي لنا أن نقاتلهم قال لا عليهم ما حملوا وعليكم ما حملتم وأخرج مسلم من حديث أبي أم سلمة مرفوعا ستكون أمراء فيعرفون وينكرون فمن كره برئ ومن أنكر سلم ولكن من رضي وتابع قالوا أفلا نقاتلهم قال لا ما صلوا ومن حديث عوف بن مالك رفعوا في حديث في هذا المعنى قلنا يا رسول الله أفلا ننابذهم عند ذلك قال لا ما أقاموا الصلاة وفي رواية له بالسيف وزاد وإذا رأيتم من ولاتكم شيئا تكرهونه فاكرهوا عمله ولا تنزعوا يدا من طاعة وفي حديث عمر في مسنده للإسماعيلي من طريق أبي مسلم الخولاني عن أبي عبيدة ابن جراح عن عمر رفعه قال أتاني جبريل فقال إن أمتك مفتتنة من بعدك فقلت من أين قال من قبل أمرائهم وقرائهم يمنع الأمراء الناس الحقوق فيطلبون حقوقهم فيفتنون ويتبع القراء هؤلاء الأمراء فيفتنون قلت فكيف يسلم من سلم منهم قال بالكف والصبر إن اعطوا الذي لهم أخذوه وإن منعوا تركوه ابن حجر says that this is not specific to the Ansar even that the Prophet was talking to them. The reason why, Ansar are not allowed to take leadership. Leadership is for who? It's only for Quraysh. The issue of leadership is for Quraysh. So the Prophet addressed Ansar. But this is not restricted to Ansar. It is also talking to every individual who is not in power. If the leader takes his rights and only looks for his rights and abandons the rights of the people, then the people upon them is to be patient and to look at their rights from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and he will be held account for what he does the day of judgment. And upon the people is to be what? It is to be patient. These ahadith, brothers, and these statements, the reason why they came about from the Prophet ﷺ is because the trial and tribulation that will come from it, if the people go against the leader, the fitna that will come from it, the bloodshed that will take place, the chaos and the anarchy that will happen, is what Islam doesn't want to bring about. When they go against him, what they were going through would be insignificant compared to what's going to happen after that. ولذلك علي بن أبي طالب, he said, إمام جائر, an oppressive leader, oppressive leader who's leading and governing the people for 40 years, oppressive, is better than one day without a leader. Who said that? Ali ibn Abi Talib. 40 years of an oppressive leader is better than one day with no leader at all. صح? What does it mean, مات ميتة جاهلية, that these people are going to die the death of jahiliyyah? What does that mean? The pre-Islamic jahiliyyah, they used to not honor the idea of a leader. They didn't believe in systems. Everyone will fight. Objection. He disagrees, he will fight. ولذلك ابن حجر, he says, والمراد بالميتة الجاهلية وهي بكسر الميم حالة الموت كموت أهل الجاهلية على ضلال وليس له إمام مطاع لأنهم كانوا لا يعرفون ذلك وليس المراد أنه يموت كافرا بل يموت عاصيا ويحتمل أن يكون التشبيه على ظاهره ومعناه أنه يموت مثل موت الجاهلي وإن لم يكن هو جاهليا أو أن ذلك ورد مورد الزجر والتنفير وظاهره غير مراد. Ibn Hajar says, what it means here is, you are going to be like pre-Islamic jahili. The way that whenever they didn't like their leader, they just went against him and they fought him. You're going to be resembling how they were when it came to law and order. They didn't believe in law and order. Islam came about and being brought what? Law and order. That's what it means. Listen to this, brothers. Ibn Battal said something very powerful. Hafidh al-Hajr transmitted this. He said, في الحديث, in this hadith is حجة, a proof في ترك الخروج على السلطان ولو جارا. Ibn Battal said, in this hadith there's an evidence that you have to stay away from going against an oppressive leader. وَقَدْ أَجْمَعَ الْفُقَهَاءُ, the scholars are unanimously in agreement, عَلَى وُجُوبِ طَاعَةِ السُّلْطَانِ الْمُتَغَلِّبِ, that we have to obey the leader that takes over by force. A man comes, and what does he do? He doesn't even ask the people to give him bay'ah. He takes over the land, and he comes into power with force. And on the radio, he announces that I am now in control of the country. No one is allowed to leave their houses. Curfew. This, everyone has to listen. He's got control of the country. Even though he came in a wrong way. The way he came about is a what? Islam doesn't affirm it, nor does it accept it. But now that he is in power, he has to be listened to and he has to be obeyed. There's no difference of opinion on this issue. That's what he's saying. وَقَدْ أَجْمَعَ الْفُقَهَاءُ عَلَى وُجُوبِ طَاعَةِ السُّلْطَانِ الْمُتَغَلِّبِ وَالْجِهَادِ مَعَهُ, and he has to be fought with in battles, not against. You're not going to fight against him, but you're going to fight with him in jihad. Do you see? وَأَنَّ طَاعَتَهُ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الْخُرُوجِ عَلَيْهِ, and the scholars are unanimously in agreement that obeying him is better than going against him. لِمَا فِي ذَلِكَ مِنْ حَقْنِ الدِّمَاءِ وَتَسْكِينِ الدَّهْمَاءِ, because this is going to lead to what? The bloodshed. And it's also going to bring what? The dim-witted ones are going to come out and they're going to cause a lot of problems. وَحُجَّتُمْ هَذَا الْخَبْرُ وَغَيْرُ مِمَّا يُسَاعِدُونَ, and the evidence for this consensus is these evidence that we took. وَلَمْ يَسْتَثْنَوْ مِنْ ذَلِكَ إِلَّا إِذَا كَانَ إِلَّا إِذَا وَقَعَ مِنَ السُّلْطَانِ الْكُفْرَ الصَّرِيحِ, and the scholars have only made an exception if he comes with disbelief. فَلَا تَجُوزُ طَاعَتُهُ. When he becomes a disbeliever, then we don't obey him. فِي ذَلِكَ in that issue. بَلْ تَجِبُ مُجَاهَدَتُهُ, then he should be fought against. لِمَنْ قَدَرَ عَلَيْهَا, the one who has the ability to do so. So even when he becomes a disbeliever, if the people don't have the ability to go against him, then they don't go against him. كَمَا فِي الْحَدِيثِ الَّذِي بَعْدَهُ. Because all of the ahkam of the sharia is manutun bil qudra, is connected to ability. You can't do something if you don't have the ability. Okay? And this is a mas'ala, as I mentioned, Ibn Battal and other great scholars have transmitted, it's a unanimous agreement. There's no khilaf. And today, anyone who ponders today and he looks at the fitna that's happening around the world by abandoning these ahadiths and rejecting these ahadiths, what he has brought about is what? Chaos. ولذلك Ibn Taymiyyah said something very powerful. Ibn Taymiyyah said, and Ibn Taymiyyah is a man who followed Islamic history, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, there has never been a group of people who went against a leader that brought about any good. There's never been a group of people who rebelled against the leader because of the evil they saw in him, and they thought to themselves that they're going to bring about good, except that what they brought about became worse than what was already there. They brought worse. Okay? So what is seen from him has to be clear-cut kufr. ولذلك Ibn Hajar brings a statement of Al-Khattabi when he came to إِلَّا أَن تَرَوْا كُفْرًا بَوَاحًا. What does it mean that you see kufran bawah? Khattabi said, بَوَاحًا يُرِيدُ ظَاهِرًا بَادِيًا. The kufr is clear in the open. مِنْ قَوْلِهِمْ باح بالشيء يبوح به بوحا وبواح وبواحا إذا أداعه وأظهره وأنكر ثابت في الدلائل بواحا. It is something that the leader is doing out in the open. Remember, if somebody does something behind closed doors, we don't judge them on that. In the Sharia, what a person is hiding behind closed doors and doesn't want to bring out to the people is not our job to bring out what they're doing in private. صح? I give you an evidence for that. The munafiqeen that were with the Prophet, there were some munafiqeen that were with the Prophet, true or false? Huh? Did the Prophet expose those munafiqeen who were hiding with him? He didn't. Are we all together? وَلِذَلِكَ some of the munafiqeen, the Prophet knew them, and some of them he didn't know, عليه الصلاة والسلام. There were some hypocrites he didn't even know. Are we all together? There were some munafiqeen in Medina that the Prophet, Allah عليه الصلاة والسلام, Allah says in the ayah, مَرَدُوا عَلَى النِّفَاقِ نَحْنُ نَعْلَمُهُمْ. There are those who have become very hypocritical in Medina who are with you. لَا تَعْلَمُهُمْ نَحْنُ نَعْلَمُهُمْ. You don't know them, Muhammad. We know them. Allah is saying that, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why didn't the Prophet bring them out in the open and tell the people about them? And why did Allah not do that? Huh? Ibn Taymiyyah took a benefit from this, which is that the person, if he's doing a sin and he hides his sin in private, he won't be held account for it in public, because it's a sin that he's been done what? Private. If a person is practicing disbelief privately, he's not going to be judged in public because he's doing it what? Privately. If a person is practicing innovation privately and he's not doing it in public, he won't be held account to it publicly. Are we all together? That's why the scholars of hadith, they divided between the one whose innovation is apparent. They say da'in ila bid'ati wa ghayru da'in ila bid'ati. The person who calls to his innovation and the one who doesn't call to his innovation. The one that calls to his innovation means he's out there telling his innovation. And there's another person, when he goes home and he closes the door, he practices his innovation. Hada bayna wa bayna Allah. If he does it, that's between him and Allah. We're not saying what he's doing is good. We're not saying what he's doing is good, but he's not the same ruling as the one who's coming out and propagating his evil. Okay? عندكم من الله فيه برهان. Look at this. Ibn Hajar says, what does it mean? عندكم من الله فيه برهان. That kufr that you're going to make him kafir for, where do you have to take it from? Brothers, the takfir, brothers, التكفير حق الله. حق الله. The takfir is the right of Allah. ثم رسوله بالنص يثبت لا بقول فلان من كان رب العالمين وعبد ورسوله قد كفراه فذاك ذو الكفران. Takfir is Allah's rights. And it's the rights of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Anyone Allah and his Messenger made a kafir, we can make them a kafir. But because you saw someone do something and you said, subhanallah, this is so big, it must be kafir. It doesn't make it kufr. Isti'ramu shay. Just because you saw something to be very big, it doesn't become kafir because you saw it to be very big. Huh? It doesn't. It doesn't make him a kafir. Takfir, it has to be evidence for it. ولذلك لكم ابن حجر said, عندكم من الله فيه برهان, ابن حجر said, أي نص آية أو خبر صحيح لا يحتمل التأويل ومقتضاه أنه لا يجوز الخروج عليه ما دام فعلهم يحتمل التأويل. قال النووي, المراد بالكفر هنا المعصية, ومعنى الحديث لا تنازعوا ولاة الأمور في ولايتهم ولا تعترضوا عليهم إلا أن تروا منهم منكرا محققا تعلمونه من قواعد الإسلام, فإذا رأيتم من ذلك فأنكروا عليهم وقولوا بالحق حق حيثما كنتم. Ibn Hajar is saying, the great scholar, he is saying that the kufr that he comes with, you have to have taken it from the Quran and the Sunnah. It can't have interpretation. Some people are saying he's kafir. Some people are saying no, he's not kafir. There's a difference here. He's not going to become a kafir for it. It has to be something that is agreed upon by everyone. Naam. In order to finish it, let me read it. I'll read it so we can finish it quickly, inshallah ta'ala. قال الإمام البخاري رحمه الله باب قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم هلاك أمتي على يد أغيلمة سفاها. قال حدثنا موسى بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا عمرو بن يحيى بن سعيد بن عمرو ابن سعيد قال أخبرني جدي قال كنت جالسا مع أبي هريرة في مسجد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالمدينة ومعنا مروان. قال أبو هريرة سمعت الصادق المصدوق يقول هلكت أمتي على يدي غلمة من قريش. فقال مروان لعنة الله عليهم غلمة. فقال أبو هريرة لو شئت أن أقول بني فلان وبني فلان لفعلت. فكنت أخرج مع جدي إلى بني مروان حين ملكوا بالشام فإذا رآهم غلمانا أحداثا قال لنا عسى هؤلاء أن يكونوا منهم. فقلنا أنت أعلم. الإمام البخاري, he said, هلاك أمتي, the destruction of my أمة is in the hand of what? على يدي غيلمة سفهاء. The destruction of my أمة is in the hands of young foolish men. The word غيلمة is تصغير for the word غيلمة is تصغير. It's when you make the word small. Who are they? They are people who are foolish and very young and don't have the wisdom. The destruction of my ummah is in the hands of these youths. That's what the Prophet ﷺ is saying. Bukhari then said, حدثنا موسى بن إسماعيل التبوذكي أبو سلمة بن أبو سلمة التبوذكي قال يسأل حدثنا عمرو بن يحيى بن سعيد بن عمرو بن سعيد قال أخبرني جدي his granddad is سعيد بن عمرو بن سعيد بن العاص قال كنت I was sitting جالسا مع أبي هريرة. I was sitting with أبو هريرة في مسجد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بالمدينة. I was sitting in the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم's masjid ومعنا مروان and مروان بن حكم was with us. Marwan ibn Hakim, by the way, he becomes leader later. تولى القضاء فيما بعد. After that, later he becomes a leader. Marwan ibn Hakim. Abu Huraira said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us, هلكت أمتي, the destruction of my ummah is على يدي غلمة. That's one narration. And that's the narration Bukhari brought. من قريش. And these foolish ones are from Quraysh. Young foolish people from Quraysh. Marwan said, when Abu Huraira told him that, he said, La'natullahi alayhim ghilmatan. He said what? He said, La'natullahi alayhim ghilmatan. The word ghilmatan, why is it mansub? Mansubun al-akhtisas. Meaning these people are restricted and cursed. And by the way, Marwan ibn Hakim, the people he's cursing are actually from his offspring. He doesn't know them. They what? They came from him. Marwan ibn Hakam, He's the one who gave birth to these children who later take over. Are you with me, brothers? Now here, Marwan ibn Hakam, he cursed these people. Okay? He cursed them. And the scholars here, they discuss, are you allowed to do la'an, a curse on someone like that? Can you do that? What's the ruling of la'anu dhalim al-mu'ayyan? A oppressive person, can you specifically say, Fulan ibn Fulan, may Allah's curse be upon him? Can you say that? The scholars, they discussed it. Are we all together? Like Yazid ibn Muawiyah and Hajjaj ibn Yusuf and others like that. Are you allowed to curse them? And Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, his son Salih asked him a question. Salih ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmad's son, Salih, he asked him, he said, Abi, إِنَّ قَوْمًا يَقُولُونَ, there are a group of people here, they are saying, إِنَّهُمْ يُحِبُّونَ يَزِيدٍ. They're saying they like Yazid ibn Muawiyah. They're saying that. And Imam Ahmad, he said, يَا أَبُنَيَّ, my son, وَهَلْ يُحِبُّ يَزِيدٌ أَحَدٌ, is there anyone who's going to love Yazid? يُؤْمِنُ بِاللَّهِ, who believes in Allah, وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ, and believes in the Day of Judgment? Is there anyone who believes in Allah and the Day of Judgment can love Yazid ibn Muawiyah? فَقُلْتُ, I then said, يَا أَبَتِي, my father, فَلِمَاذَا لَا تَلْعَنُ, then why don't you curse him? Why don't you what? Curse him. Why don't you curse him? فَقَالَ, he then said, يَا بُنَيَّ, my son, مَتَى رَأَيْتَ أَبَاكَ, when did you see your father, يَلْعَنُ أَحَدًا, when did you ever see your father curse a person specifically? Have you ever seen your father ever curse someone specifically? Even Imam Ahmad's oldest son was Salih, right? Salih was the oldest son of Imam Ahmad. And his youngest son was who? Huh? Abdullah was the youngest one. Between Abdullah and Salih is over 20 years. And who was more eager and hungry for knowledge, both of them? Abdullah really used to study. وَلِذَلِكَ صَالِحُ used to sleep in his dad's dars. He used to get tired and just go to sleep. And Abdullah, as a young kid, would write, take notes. And he would write, and Salih would be sleeping. And Ahmed would get angry. And he would say to the mother of Salih, what is this? Look at him. He's sleeping in the middle of the dars. He wants to go to sleep. As for Abdullah, لكن لازم أبو, he was stuck to his father. He used to take from him, narrate from him. And he narrated a lot from him. And he's the narrator who narrated from the Musnad from his father. And worked on the Musnad. Abdullah. Salih said, I asked my father about Yazid. Are we all together? So Yazid is differed upon, by the way. There's a difference of opinion amongst the Salaf regarding Yazid. Some defend him. And the view that Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah did take was the view of defending him. And some of the scholars, they don't defend Yazid. They saw him as an oppressive leader. Hajjaj, we're going to come to him soon, and we're going to see who he is soon, inshallah. He's going to come to us, his story, and what he did. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi. So are we allowed to curse a person specifically? And Imam Ahmad here, he didn't want to do it. That which seems apparent is, you're not allowed to curse a person by their name. But you are allowed to curse a person by their description. Like the Prophet ﷺ did, when he said, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ السَّارِقَ, may Allah's curse be upon a thief. General. May Allah's curse be upon the thief. But when the Prophet ﷺ named a group of people by name, and he said, Allahumma la'an fulan, Allahumma la'an fulan, Allahumma la'an fulan, Allahumma la'an fulan, oh Allah's curse be upon so and so, and so and so, and so and so, the ayah came down, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٍ, Muhammad, this is not your affairs. This matter is not for you. The ayah came down, telling the Prophet ﷺ off for cursing a people by name. Are we all together? Then, cursing a person by name is not correct in our religion, and it's what? أَلَا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الظَّالِمِينَ, may Allah's curse be upon the oppressors. That's it, general. أَمَا تَعْيِيمْ, as for specifying it, then the evidence is seem strong that you can't. وَلِذَلِكَ أَبُو هُرَيْرَ didn't curse. Even though he's a Sahabi who's telling the story, he didn't do it, لكن مروان بن حكم, Marwan ibn Hakam did it. And Abu Huraira used to seek refuge in Allah from the days that these young foolish people are going to come into power. And he even knew them by name. That's why he said, Abu Huraira, he said, If you want, and you guys wish so, I can tell you who they are. I can say Fulani ibn Fulan and Fulani ibn Fulan. I can tell you, I know their names. He knew these people who were going to bring the destruction to this ummah. He knew them by name. Okay? He knew them by what? By name. He knew their names. I can tell you who they are. Here we take from it a couple of things, inshallah ta'ala. Which is, Abu Huraira knows their names and who they are. And he chooses not to mention it. Why does he choose not to mention their names? The reason is because of the issue that Bukhari wants to point out here, which is that if he mentions their names, سَيَتَرَتَّبُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ الْمَفَأْسِدِ مَا اللَّهُ بِهِ عَلِيمٌ There's going to come a lot of trials and tribulations from it. The people are going to uprise and they're going to cause mischief on this earth regarding it. So Abu Huraira withheld that information and didn't tell anyone about it. And he died with not even mentioning it. But he mentioned what year it's going to be. He knew what year it's going to happen. And he said, Allahumma, Abu Huraira is saying this, Allahumma, O Allah, inni a'udhu bika min ra'si sittina. I seek refuge in you from the year 60 Hijriyah. When 60 year Hijri starts, oh Allah, please don't make me reach that. Wa imaratu sibyan. And when these foolish kids come into power, oh Allah, please take my life before that. Sanata sittina was the year Yazid ibn Muawiyah took over. And Abu Huraira died what? 2 years before that. He died the year 58, and some of the riwayat mention he died 59, 1 or 2 years before it. Sanata sittina, who took over? Yazid ibn Muawiyah. Yazid ibn Muawiyah took over at a time when there were senior companions alive. Like Abdullah ibn Umar was alive. Like, for example, Hassan ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib was alive. Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib was alive. Hassan already died a long time. Like, Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib is alive. صح? Are we all together, brothers? And it was at the time of Yazid ibn Muawiyah that the noble companion was killed, Al Hussein ibn Ali in Karbala. صح? Hussein went to Iraq because of the people of Iraq inviting him and telling him to come over. And when he got there with 70 family members of his and his children and his wives, what happened? The army and the men of Yazid ibn Muawiyah who were appointed in Iraq, what did they do? They surrounded what? Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib. And Hussein ibn Ali, when he realized that he's not enough to fight, he surrendered and he said, look, I'm given a proposal, I want to be followed. One, let me go back to Medina. I'm just going to go back to Medina and let's stop this. Number two, he said to the man, send me to who? Yazid ibn Muawiyah in Sham. Let me go to him. I'll talk to him man to man. And the third one is, if you don't want to do those two for me, then send me to the Thughur, the border. I'll be a border patrol for the Muslims. Those three is what I request for. Are we all together? Just three options. And it was then said to Hussein ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, neither of those three are going to be done for you. The only way you're going to go to Yazid ibn Muawiyah is humiliated. You're going to be chained, number one. You're going to be placed on a donkey. You're going to go to him dhul and belittled and put down. Hussein said, my nafs can't accept that. I can't let that happen. So he took all of his wives and his children and the children, his grandchildren, and all of them, he put them behind and he said, I'll fight. And Hussein got killed in that place that day. So these were the evil things that happened at that time. So even that though, the truth should be mentioned, when the issue reached Yazid ibn Muawiyah and it was informed that Hussein was killed, he said, why did you guys not bring him to me? Why didn't he requested for three options. One option should have been given to him. Yazid did say that. But the people who were placed in power in Iraq for Yazid, they were what? They were those type of people. They were those type of people. So, these are people who are foolish in their decision making. And this teaches us another thing, which is, brothers and sisters, the importance of those people who are old in age. This hadith benefits us the people who are senior in age and their value. The people who are senior in age, they're the ones that we go to and we reference back at the times of fitan, times of trials and tribulations. We don't go to the young people. We don't go to the people who are young. However much knowledge we think they have, we go to the kibar, those who are old in age. الَّذِينَ جَمَعُوا بَيْنَ الْعِلْمِ وَالْخِبْرَةِ. Those who've combined between knowledge and what? Wisdom. Are we all together? That combine between what? Knowledge and wisdom. Because the reason is because the people who are old in age, with the knowledge that they have, they don't have the hudud al dunya, the love for the dunya, and they can't be swayed off because all they're waiting for is years to live and die. So those are the type of people that are referred back to at that time. Also, what is taken from this hadith is, and is benefited from this hadith is, when Abu Hurairah said, Allahumma inni a'udhu bika min sanati sittina, amma min ra'si sittina, wa imarati sibyan, it shows us, and we take from this hadith, Ibn Hajar said, how it's recommended to run away from places of trials and tribulations. Places where there are fitan happening, don't stay around. Don't be in those places. The lands of the non-Muslims, leave it. Lands where there are fitna, even if it's land of Muslims, if you can't practice your religion, just leave it. And go. Hafiz al-Hajj, look what he said. He said, وَيُؤْخَذُ مِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ إِسْتِحْبَابُ هِجْرَانِ الْبَلْدَةِ الَّتِي يَقَعُ فِيهَا إِظْهَارُ الْمَعْصِيَةِ فَإِنَّهَا سَبَبُ وُقُوعِ الْفِتَنِ الَّتِي يَنْشَوْ عَنْهَا عُمُومُ الْهَلَاكِ. قال ابن وهب عن ابن عن مالك تهجر الأرض التي يصنع فيها المنكر جهارا وقد صنع ذلك جماعة من السلف. Some of the Salaf, they used to come to a land, and if they stayed in that land for one day, and no one came and asked them any questions, like Sufyan al-Thawri when he came to a land, and then no one came to him to ask him questions, or he didn't see no students of knowledge, and then he said to his students, "Come on, let's leave. This is Ardu Su, an evil land. This is not a place where people don't want to learn their religion and they're not hungry for knowledge. This is an evil land. Let's leave it." We take that from the hadith. Also, Ibn Battal, he extracted from this a point that I mentioned before, but it's worth mentioning it. Ibn Battal, rahimahullah, he's one of the shurrah of Bukhari. He explained Bukhari. I'm reading it from the Kitab Fathul Bari. He said, وَفِي هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ أَيْضًا حُجَّةٌ لِمَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ تَرْكِ الْقِيَامِ عَلَى السُّلْطَانِ وَلَوْ جَارًا. In this hadith is another benefit, which is what we mentioned before, that you can't go against the oppressive leader. Okay, لأنه صلى الله عليه وسلم أعلم أبا هريرة بأسماء هؤلاء. Abu Huraira knew the names, and the Prophet told him the names. وأسماء آبائهم, and he even knew the names of their fathers. ولم يأمرهم بالخروج عليهم, and the Prophet never told him go against them. And Abu Huraira didn't say to Marwan ibn Hakim, when you see these people, go against them. He didn't say that. مع إخبار أن الهلاك الأمة على أيديهم, even that though he mentioned to them that when they come, they're going to bring destruction. You see, لِكَوْنِ الْخُرُوجِ أَشَدُّ فِي الْهَلَاكِ وَأَقْرَبُ إِلَى اسْتِئْصَالِ مِنْ طَاعَتِهِمْ. The reason Hafiz ibn Hajr said is because going against them is going to bring a greater fitna than the corruption that they're going to bring. فَاخْتَارَ أَخَفَّ الْمَفْسَدَتَيْنِ وَأَيْسَرَ الْأَمْرَيْنِ. And Abu Huraira looked at the two issues, and also before him the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the people were instructed the lesser of the two harms. The lesser of what? The two harms. And also the issue that Marwan ibn Hakam's own children were these people, Ibn Hajar mentioned it. He said, تنبيه, يتعجب, he said, it's fascinating. من لعني مروان الغلمة. It's fascinating that Marwan cursed these young foolish kids. مع أن ظاهر أنهم من ولده. Even though these are his own offspring. فكأن الله تعالى. Ibn Hajar is saying, it's as though. فكأن الله تعالى أجر ذلك على لسانه. It is like Allah tabarak wa ta'ala wanted this to come from the mouth of Marwan ibn Hakam. لِيَكُونَ أَشَدَّ فِي الْحُجَّةِ عَلَيْهِمْ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّعِظُونَ. So it can become more of a proof against these foolish people that their forefather had said that. نعم. الإمام البخاري رحمه الله إذن سأل باب قول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ويل للعرب من شر قد اقترب. قال حدثنا مالك بن إسماعيل قال حدثنا ابن عيينة أنه سمع الزهري عن عروة عن زينب بنت أم سلمة عن أم حبيبة عن زينب بنت جحش رضي الله عنهن أنها قالت استيقظ النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من النوم محمرا وجهه يقول لا إله إلا الله ويل للعرب من شر قد اقترب فتح اليوم من ردم يأجوج وماجوج مثل هذه وعقد سفيان 90 أو 100 قيل أن أهلك وفينا الصالحون قال نعم إذا كثر الخبث. قال حدثنا أبو نعيم قال حدثنا ابن عيينة عن الزهري وحدثني محمود قال أخبرنا عبد الرزاق قال أخبرنا معمر عن معمر عن الزهري عن عروة عن أسامة بن زيد رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال أشرف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم على أطم من أطام المدينة فقال هل ترون ما أرى؟ قالوا لا نرى. قال فإني لا أرى قال فإني لا أرى الفتن تقع خلال بيوتكم كوقع القطر. الإمام البخاري رحمه الله, he chapted here the chapter waylun. The word waylun, the word waylun here, what does it mean? It means two meanings. Write it down. The word waylun, you're going to see that a lot. Waylun is a word tuqalu inda husul al-halaka. It is used at the time of destruction. The time when the destruction is happening, use wayl. It's used. Also, it is used before it when it's about to happen, and it's also used when it happens. It's used when it's about to happen, and it's also used when it happens. That's the usage of the word. That's when it's used. Okay? لكن, the word means عذاب. The word waylun means adabun. And there's another view which is wadin fi jahannama. It's a valley in Jahannam. And this is transmitted from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, he said, عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال, that the Prophet said, الويل واد في جهنم يهوي فيه الكافر 40 خريفا قبل أن يبلغ قعره. حافظ ابن كثير, he said, لم ينفرد به ابن لهيعة ولكن الآفة ممن بعده وهذا الحديث بهذا الإسناد مرفوع منكر والله أعلم. The ruling of this hadith is disputed, whether the Prophet said it or not, which is that Waylun is a valley in Jahannam. It's the name of a valley in Jahannam. It has also been transmitted from Abdullah ibn Abbas that he chose the opinion that the word Waylun is wadin fi Jahannam. Why did the Prophet restrict the Arabs? Why did he say waylun lil arabi? Destruction is to the Arabs. Huh? Or the Arabs. The destruction is to the Arabs. Why did the Prophet specifically say Arabs? Why Arabs? Over everyone else. Ibn Hajar says, rahimahullah ta'ala, innama khassa al-arab bi-dhikri li'annahum awwalu man dakhala fi al-islam. The reason is because they were the first people to enter Islam. وللإنذار بأن الفتن إذا وقعت كان الهلاك أسرع إليه. And the second reason is that when the fitna happens, the people is going to most suffer from it is the Arabs first. They're going to suffer the most from it. Those are the two views that are mentioned here. The third view that I think is the strongest is that they were the only Muslims at that time, the overwhelming majority of the Muslims. The bulk of the Muslims that were sitting in front of the Prophet ﷺ was who? The Arabs. And sometimes I want to mention this point, which is important, brothers. Sometimes you find some people that belittle the Arabs. Arabs. And this is very dangerous. Very dangerous. لأن the Prophet is an Arab. And belittling the Arabs can encompass the Prophet in there as well. It's very dangerous. Are we all together, brothers? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what? Chose them. If you have something against a particular person, then name that person and deal with that person. Like to take the whole entire people that the Prophet was from, and that Abu Bakr was from, and Umar was from, Uthman was from, and Ali was from. And this concept of belittling the Arabs came through colonization. And it's come from the non-Muslims. Are we all together? It's a stepping stone to belittle your scripture and your religion. Are we all together, brothers? لِأَنَّ I've said this before, the Arabic language is the language of every single Muslim. Okay? The Arabic language is not owned by the Arabs. It's owned by who? Every Muslim. That's your language. The Arabic language is what? It's your language. So the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the Arabs here. This hadith, there's a benefit that I want to mention regarding it. This hadith, the riwayah that we have in front of us right now, or the one that I just read right now, Imam Malik said, Imam al-Bukhari, he said, Qala, everybody, if you could just look at your copy, inshaAllah ta'ala, it was a very good benefit here. He said, Qala haddathana Malik ibn Ismail, Qala haddathana ibn Uyaynat, anna sami'a al-Zuhriya, an Urwata an Zainaba binti Ummi Salama. So the first one is what? Zainaba binti Ummi Salama. That's the first person, underline that name. Okay? Zainaba binti Ummi Salama, underline that name. The second name that I want you to underline is Ummi Habibata. That's the second name. The third name is Zainaba binti Jahshin. The third name is Zainaba binti Jahshin. That I want you to underline. Those three are female companions. These are what? They are thalathu sahabiyat, three female companions. And I'll mention the benefit later regarding this, inshaAllah ta'ala, after the Salatu al-Maghrib, inshaAllah.